Growing Up Lutheran. What does this mean? Hi, I'm Janet.
And I'm Suzanne.
We are two 100% Norwegian Lutheran farm girls who didn't turn and who didn't dance and who memorized all of Luther's small catechism, and it wasn't so small then. This is most certainly true. We are experts on the topic of growing up Lutheran. We were both born in October 1946 to Lutheran farm parents, Janet at Hillsboro, North Dakota, and Suzann near Evansville, Minnesota. We were both baptized into the Lutheran faith in November of 1946, the same month that our dads took out a $1,000 Lutheran Brotherhood life insurance policy on us. We were both confirmed in May of 1961 at Our Savior's Lutheran, different churches in different states.
We both grew up wearing garter belts and attending Sunday school, Bible camp, Luther League, and league conventions. We both attended Augsburg College in Minneapolis, and both married rural Scandinavian American Lutheran men who didn't dance either. Today, when we aren't writing or out speaking, we spend our time memorizing our daughters' and sons-in-law's ever-changing addresses and phone numbers.
And leaving please vacuum and dust notes for our husbands. And
coping with hot flashes.
So if you twirled around church basement poles instead of danced.
And if you played with rook cards instead of face cards.
Then take off your boots.
Pour yourself a jelly jar plumb full of Watkins orange nectar.
Sit up straight. And
pay attention. P.S. We still have those $1,000 life insurance policies, because we're not dead yet.
This is most certainly true.
Like Luther's explanation of the Catechism, we have divided this book into two parts. Part one, what does this mean? And part two, how is this done? Here we go with part one. What does this mean?
Chapter 1. And his name shall be called Gilman Einar Stedje. A child didn't become a real Lutheran until he was baptized in a Lutheran setting. Some Lutheran babies, who were born in a Catholic-run hospital, were secretly baptized by the good nuns, but Lutherans knew that this didn't count. Lutherans have never believed in doing things to excess. This, coupled with the fact that so many Lutherans settled on the prairies, led to the Brill Cream theory of baptism. Unlike the Baptists, who used a lot of water, Lutherans believe that a little dab will do ya. Good Lutheran parents baptized their babies when their relatives could make it.
Yeah, and before the child got too big.
Normally, Lutherans baptize their babies at about 4 to 8 weeks old. If they waited any longer, parishioners' tongues would wag, and conscientious Lutheran parents would feel the chill coming from the pews. In other words, it wasn't suffer the little children, but suffer the parents who should have known better than to wait so long.
Especially if the baby fussed and acted up during baptism.
The confirmed Lutheran relatives who stood up at the baptismal font with the parents and who were invited over for dinner after the services were usually called sponsors. If it was the baptism of the third or fourth child, the parents often skipped having the sponsors over for dinner.
That was okay, though, because these babies didn't have a baby book or baby picture either. Often there was no picture of these children until they began mandatory attendance at public school. Not having these special baby frills wasn't because the parents loved these children any less. It's just the way it was.
Some people, especially those who had family members who had married outside the faith, called sponsors godparents. But for most Lutherans, the word godparents sounded too much like something the Fish on Friday crew would say, and it conjured up thoughts of the mob and the mafia. Thus, Lutherans were more comfortable with the term sponsors. Sponsors were usually in their 20s or 30s. Any older, and most Lutherans felt they would be taking chances at not having them around for confirmation. Most girls who were baptized Lutheran in the 40s or 50s were given a sensible, pronounceable first name like Jean, Janet, or Judy. Their second name was usually in honor of an older deserving relative. These were names like Helen, Alice, or May. Girls received either a cross on a chain or a spoon as a gift from their sponsors.
Especially if they were Norwegian Lutheran, then they got a spoon.
Usually they were baptized in a modest little white dress. Invariably, it was new because there wasn't anything left over from the Depression to pass down.
Boys who were baptized Lutheran usually got a couple of bucks and a nice card from their sponsors, and they were named after their dad or one of the grandparents. They had regular names like Einar, Emil, or Edward. They were normally dressed in a little pale blue suit, which was bought locally.
Probably at the Johnson store.
The church furnished a baptismal certificate signed by the pastor. Since most Lutherans didn't deem it necessary to take any pictures at baptism, the certificate is the only memento Lutheran kids have. To this day, most Lutherans keep their certificate with their LB or AAL insurance policies in a safe, dry place. This is most certainly true. Chapter 2, Little Lutherans in Limbo. After a child was baptized Lutheran, but before starting Sunday school, the cry room crew got enrolled for $1 in the local church's chapter of the Lutheran Women's Missionary Federation,
which had headquarters located at Minneapolis 15, Minnesota.
Even though cradle roll was meant to interest Lutheran children in missionary work, most Lutheran children were too young to know that there were heathens in Alaska who hadn't seen the light yet.
As Mrs. Byron C. Nelson wrote in a 1939 tract published by the Literature Committee of the Women's Missionary Federation of the Norwegian Lutheran Church in America,
which was located in Minneapolis 15, Minnesota,
these dollars helped finance an adult missionary who worked among their fur-robed brothers of the North and who would hazard the icy North to do outreach work for the little Lutheran missionaries back home who couldn't yet walk.
Once these little Lutherans got old enough to think, they never thought much about cradle roll because there were never any catechization questions pertaining to it. Mothers of cradle roll children received tracts and pamphlets on the missionary work that the cradle roll supported. Even though children were dropped from the rolls when they started Sunday school, cradle roll membership was the second rite of passage for Lutherans. Somewhere between joining cradle roll and leaving for the mission field in Alaska, many Lutheran kids, especially those in their terrible twos, spent some time in the cry room. Just as the Catholics had limbo,
a place for unbaptized babies located somewhere between heaven and hell or Minneapolis and St. Paul,
the Lutherans who went to town churches had the cry room, a place for fussy babies located at the back of the church. Lutherans have no direct recollection of being in the cradle roll or the cry room. They learn about cry rooms, now called nurseries, when they have children of their own, and about cradle roll when they are middle-aged and go through the stuff that their parents saved and happen to find their cradle roll certificate in with old nut cups left over from mother-daughter teas and yellowing mimeographed pictures of pilgrims that they had colored in the third grade. Along with their certificate, these middle-aged cradle roll graduates know they belong to cradle roll because they have birthday cards from the WMF glued in their scrapbooks to prove it.
This is most certainly true. chapter 3. Let all the earth keep silence before or him. 1 hour every Sunday morning from Labor Day to Memorial Day,
the months when you couldn't wear white shoes,
Lutheran children between the ages of 3 and 18 gathered in church basements across the nation to sing and to pray, to memorize and to play. It was Sunday school time. Lutheran parents, from the regular steadfast, you can always count on them being their pillar types, down to the Christmas Easter attendees who stayed away 50 weeks of the year because they felt there were just too many hypocrites sitting in the pew, made sure their children faithfully attended Sunday school. While the pillar types were busy teaching Sunday school, the Christmas Easter folks were sitting in cars outside the church reading the Sunday paper. For children of the pillar types, Sunday school began on Saturday night with a bath and the parents' proverbial question,
"Do you have your lessons learned?"
And the statement,
"Let me hear your memory work."
After the milking and chores was done Sunday morning, breakfast was eaten and nickels were tied in the corner of the hankies for the Sunday school offering. The Lutheran families in the regular steadfast faction dressed all up. Mom in her good girdle, hat, gloves, and Sunday dress, Dad in his only suit, a white shirt, tie, and hat, and children in their church clothes. Boys in a two-piece suit that Mom lowered the cuffs on monthly, and girls in a Sunday dress and Sunday shoes with clean white anklets in the summer and long white stockings hung onto a garter belt in the winter. They went off to church to get their weekly religion
and to have some coffee.
The children were brought up to the church basement by their parents. After the kids removed their coats and overshoes, they quietly sat down in rows on little red or brown chairs that were placed in and amongst the church basement poles to wait for the superintendent to say,
"Good morning, children. This is the day that the Lord has given. We will open by singing, 'The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him.'"
It was a good song because it let the children of the Christmas Easter types know that in this setting there would be no shuffling feet, poking, or any other type of monkey business. Following the opening song, little Lutherans bowed their heads, folded their hands, and closed their eyes for an opening prayer. Other than an occasional offering nickel rolling on the floor, all was silent. Opening exercise continued with more songs like "Jesus Loves Me" and "This Little Light of Mine." A lesson about moral issues like sharing, helping, and not hitting. The offering was collected and sent to foreign mission fields. Before the closing prayer, Lutheran children who were having birthdays the following week got to come to the front of the room to put their pennies, one for each year of life, into the birthday bank. While the superintendent held the bank, the children who were sitting in their chairs sang "Happy Birthday." The Lutheran birthday children were in glory because it was a wonderful, non-bragging Lutheran way to let everyone else know that it was their day to shine. After the closing prayer, the children and their teachers were excused, row by row, and sent to their individual learning centers.
Some in the kitchen, some enclosed behind Sunday school dividers or curtains, and the older students to the furnace room.
After attendance was taken, Lutheran children learned about Daniel in the den of lions and saw stories enacted on flannel graph boards. They recited memory work and got gold, blue, or red stars for learning it by heart. Towards the end of the hour, when the teacher saw that no one was paying attention anymore, she put away her books and let the children color Joseph's coat of many colors or play with blocks and clay while they waited for their parents to pick them up.
Lutheran children with perfect attendance spent 540 hours of their lives in Sunday school. Each year, the Sunday school recognized those who had perfect attendance or those who had only missed one or two Sundays due to measles, mumps, chicken pox, or the Asiatic flu. These conscientious Lutheran children received either a certificate, a little book, a pin, or a bar to attach to their Sunday school pin for being so diligent. Lutherans didn't fully complete this third rite of passage until they graduated from high school and were honored at the senior Sunday school banquet. From then on, they were no longer required to attend Sunday school, only to teach it. This is most certainly true.
Jeg så glad hver julekveld, til da ble Jesus født. Da lyste stjernen som en sol, og engler sang så søt. Da tenner moder...
Chapter 4. The Best Bathrobe Pageant Ever. Planning for the Sunday School Christmas program started in earnest around the middle of October when the Sunday School superintendent started to line things up in a notebook as well as in her head. September was always taken up with the average basic Sunday School organizational problems, like where in the world to put all the kids, how to recruit more teachers, and who will reorder more Sunday School material, and of course, harvest. The real work for the teacher began in November, when the Sunday school superintendent called a meeting to tell the teachers what the program was about, who was Mary.
Yeah, either her daughter or the pastor's daughter.
And who was Joseph.
Yeah, either the pastor's son or someone else who was decent and would work out.
Yeah, decent, yeah. Well, she enlisted the teachers to help her pick out the wise men, shepherds, and angels. She needed kids in these parts who not only would behave and follow directions, but ones who were tall enough so that they wouldn't trip on the costumes. Of course, the chosen had to have parents who were dependable enough to get them to practices and
to get them there on time.
The costumes, mostly old bathrobes, were dug out of the storeroom at this time and quickly checked over for mending or approval. The real work for the children started in November, too. After Reformation Sunday, opening exercises were taken up with learning one new Christmas song and the second and third verses of familiar ones. They were sung over and over and over again. Right after Thanksgiving, the teacher sent home the pieces.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.